Penguin Random House Audio presents Defiant Joy. Find the hope to light your way, even in the darkness. This is the author, Jennifer Michelle Greenberg. This book is dedicated, with much gratitude and love, to Jason, my safety in the storm, and to our three little girls, Eloin, Leonor, and Guinevere. I know that God loves me, because he gave me you. Letter to the listener. Dear listener, my study of joy began many years ago. It was October 2012, and as I looked into the blue eyes of my beautiful newborn daughter, I felt nothing. There was this void in my heart, as if someone had reached in and scooped out part of my personality, removing my ability to feel happy. It terrified me. Of all the times in my life, this was supposed to be the brightest, but I felt numb and deadened. Part of this was no doubt due to exhaustion. As a new mom, I was still recovering from pregnancy and waking up every 2 hours at night to care for a colicky infant. Another part was because of postpartum depression, which I eventually sought medical treatment to recover from. But still another part was that I didn't understand joy or know where it came from. I'd never been taught that, not even in church. So I set out on an expedition to uncover this mysterious treasure I was missing. I came to find that joy, real, pure, eternal joy, is a gift from God. It's not something I can generate on my own. It's not a situation where I can fake it till I make it. Most important, to feel joy, I first needed to learn to rest in the knowledge that God is the creator and sustainer of my faith. Faith, like joy, isn't something I can muster up. It's not a job I can accomplish or a chore I can check off my to-do list. God isn't a celestial snack machine who, when given the right amount of change, dispenses spiritual treats. That's just not how life works, and the Bible never says it does. But I didn't come to this conclusion quickly or easily. It took a lot of study, prayer, and wrestling with God in Scripture. You see, as a child, I was taught that in order to be a good Christian, I needed to always act happy. Even if my situation was stressful or sad, I was expected to pretend I was okay. You've probably encountered similar ideas. Self-help gurus claim that if you have a positive attitude, you'll attract positive energy and good things will happen to you. Prosperity gospel teachers claim that if you have enough faith, think positively, and donate money to their ministries, you'll receive health, wealth, and well-being. I recently heard the testimony of a dear sister in Christ who believed that her refrigerator had remained in good working order because she had faithfully tithed for 30 years. She viewed this as a sign that God was pleased with her obedience. But what happens when her fridge finally does break? In that moment, will she think God is displeased? Will she think it's because she's done something wrong? The logical inference is that if something bad happens to you, it must be your fault. If you experience suffering, it must be because God is disappointed in your flimsy faith or sketchy prayer life. If you're sad, exhausted, lonely, or anxious, if you lose your job, get a flat tire, or your kid gets a bad grade in school, it must be because you're a bad Christian or not a real Christian at all. In this book, we're going to upend those lies. We're going to flip the tables of the money changers and the happiness gurus. We're going to learn what joy really means. And let's not stop there. Let's get into the trenches and dismantle the lies that drown out our joy. Let's deconstruct the false theologies that destabilize our faith and make us feel far from God. In their place, let's allow Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, to overwhelm us with his joy. My plan for this book is to take you on a spiritual, archaeological dig. We'll take a deep dive into Scripture, excavate, and dust off the joy of the Lord. We'll rediscover the promises of God that have become tarnished, hidden, and sometimes even lost. Together, let's experience joy again, maybe even for the first time ever. Much love, Jen. Part 1. Joy is a promise from God. You have not come to a mountain that can be touched and that is burning with fire, to darkness, gloom, and storm. But you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. You have come to thousands upon thousands of angels in joyful assembly. Hebrews 12, 18 and 22. Chapter 1. Inexplicable joy. How can we be happy when life is sad? Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. 1 Peter 1, verse 8. I have a wonderful life. I've been married to my best friend, Jason, for 16 years. We have three beautiful daughters who are brilliant, hilarious, feisty, and imaginative. We live in a pretty house in a safe neighborhood with a mischievous husky puppy named Luna and a chronically underwhelmed cat named Shadowfax. Jason's parents live just a few minutes away, so every busy week is punctuated with family gatherings where Papa and Daddy grill dinner and Grandma coordinates crafts or gardening projects. Not everything is perfect, and we have our days. But in many ways, it's an idyllic life. A few weeks ago, I was sitting next to my youngest daughter. I can't remember what we were talking about, probably Minecraft, toads, fashion, or one of her friends. But suddenly, I was overwhelmed with joy and gratitude for her. She's a spunky and precocious first grader with curly hair, missing teeth, and bright blue eyes like her daddy's. Looking into her eyes is like seeing God's promises fulfilled, because she has come true. I never thought I would have these blessings. I never thought life could be this happy, because it wasn't always this way. I grew up in a church-going, homeschooling family with four younger sisters. My mom was a talented artist who loved to paint, draw, and teach children. My father had a PhD in biology, taught Sunday school, and could debate any theologian. But despite all his education and intellect, he couldn't seem to understand love. Despite every reason and opportunity for happiness and health, our home was marred by abuse. Child abuse may seem like an odd thing to talk about in a book about joy, but in order to uncover joy, we must understand what hides it. What are the sins that blind us to it? What are the traumas that make it difficult to grasp? What are the fears that stifle it? For me, I was taught that my emotions didn't matter or weren't real. If I was offended by my father's cruel or perverse words, I was told to stop being dramatic and act happy. If I was frightened by his violence and unchecked rage, I was told to honor him and act as if he were honorable. Even if my dad didn't apologize, I was told to forgive him, which, at least in our family, meant pretending that everything was fine. So, by our definition, to forgive was to lie. I had to tell him I forgave him, even though I wanted to run away. I had to tell him I was okay, and then go ice my hand-shaped bruises. I had to thank him for his compliments, and then go put on another layer of clothes. But if I didn't forgive, if I refused to lie and express my sorrow, pain, or anger, I was told that God would not forgive me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.